right. Greed works.
Hello and welcome to another episode of Let's Play Wall Street Raider. I'm RakeM, your host. Last time we bought CenterCore and we ran it up to $13.5 billion. And as I say that, you may notice that my cash on hand is $15.6 billion. But we still owe $2.2 billion, somewhere in that neighborhood in taxes. We'll be paying that momentarily. Before we begin, I just want to say that we're going to be doing a couple of new things this episode. There may be a little bit less action than you're used to. I don't think that we're going to be making a lot of money this episode. We're mostly going to be setting up ourselves for making a lot of money in the next episode. This particular episode is going to explain short sales and interest rate swaps. You're still going to see us buy some stocks and whatnot, but I'm not really going to explain what I'm doing other than to say why I'm buying the companies I'm buying. So without further ado, let's get into it. At the end of episode 2, we sold all of our holdings of CenterCore and took a profit, which leaves us with cash on hand of $15.6 billion. But not all of that money is ours. We still haven't paid our taxes, which is shown on this report. We have $2,123,000,000 that we have to pay in tax. So we could just let the simulation run and let the taxes be paid at the end of the quarter. But I'm about to do a bunch of investing and I don't want to spend the money that's supposed to go to taxes and end up having a bank loan. So I can go to the miscellaneous menu and prepay my income tax. And now it's paid. So when I invest, I know that I only have $13.5 billion. And I don't have to remember to keep that reserve. So we're going to go to the general menu again, industrial growth rates, and look for a place to invest. And it looks like, wow, a lot of these have gone negative now. So there, we may have few choices. I mean, biotechnology still looks good. That's the one we just left. But we know that there's three companies there. The biggest three are overexpanding. So that return's going to go down. I mean, that doesn't mean that we shouldn't invest there, but we're going to look for something better. Computer peripherals is okay. It's not great, but it's okay. You know, if these return rates weren't so low, I would be okay with those. Holy cow. Negative 37%. I don't think I've ever seen an average rate that low. We got to look at that. There's probably some companies in there we can short sell. Oh, definitely. He's way overpriced for the amount that he's losing. Let's sell him short immediately. So you go to buy, sell stock short, Union Pacific, and 20% is the max. Okay, so we sold it for We short sold it for almost $2 billion. And his stock price right now is $10.87. So we'll want that to go down as much as possible. And the thing about short sales is there's a cap on how much you can earn. So the most we can earn from this is the $19.87. Because we're betting on the stock to go down, not go up. And there's a limit to how far it can go down. I mean, zero is the lowest it can go. Whereas when you're buying a stock to raise the price, there's no limit to how high it can grow. So let's look at the industry again, see if there's any others we want to short sell. So he's already dropped. So we've already made money. What did he drop to? Well, that hasn't updated yet. So let's sell this one also, short sell it. Okay, 20%. And, of course, this is a much smaller company, so there's not as much to be made there. Let's look and see if there's any others. This one, maybe. I mean, we could short sell them all, but I don't want to just do it indiscriminately. We got, you know, as long as we hold these stocks, even though we've short sold them, we're on the hook for the dividend. So I don't want to really buy this one because his dividend is so high. And even though we're short selling 20%, that doesn't mean we take control. We still don't have control. So we can't, you know, just change his dividend down to zero and be okay with it. So, let's take a look at NSC. They're going to lose $1.43 a share. And they have 500 shares. So they're going to lose, 500 and 600 change, whatever. I mean, that's a huge portion of their net worth. So let's short sell him as well. And there we go. Okay, I think that's going to be it for the short sales. The rest of them are trading too close to their net worth. I mean, they'll still go down, but, you know, I'd rather do a short sale when I'm guaranteed to make a nice profit. And just to show you what it looks like on your tax basis info. So on the tax basis report, the cost is what we paid, and the value is what it's worth now. And you notice that in this case, the value has gone down. So that number is actually higher than the cost. And the difference between those two is what we've made. So as long as the stock goes down, that value will approach zero. Zero being the highest it can go on a short sale. And it looks kind of weird on the tax basis report, especially if you have stocks that you've, you know, traditionally bought, because you're combining two different sale types, one that shows a negative value and another a positive. Okay, so let's get back to our industrial growth rates and see what we're going to do here. There's not really any clear winners. Network and telecom is all right, except for the low rate. Maybe there's some discount companies to be had there. Let's take a look. No, Ciena Corp's the only one that's really below zero or below 100. Qualcomm, maybe. I mean, they're the next lowest. This one's worth too much. We really can't take control of it. So let's take a look and see how big Qualcomm is. Well, we can buy them for $2.2 billion and then give them a bunch of cash and see if they can't turn it around. Let's look and see what their management is. Grossly incompetent. And the network, or the supply demand, is deteriorating. I know it's kind of iffy. Let me look at the industry again. So it's growing at 8%. And these guys are just killing it. Now, we could turn this company around from a management standpoint and probably get their returns up to the 20 range, but it would take probably 3 quarters to do it. I mean, we would be holding steady for 3 quarters before making a profit. So let's find something else. Let's look at biotechnology again. See, the returns are a lot better. And there's some bargains to be had. So Immunex, PDLI, Abgenix, and Millennium. All four of those look like they'd be okay. Now, this guy is still growing like gangbusters. But, you know, we could just turn the companies around and we wouldn't have to grow very much because the returns are still in decent territory. So, let's look at Immunex. They lost money last year, projected to make money this year. They're grossly incompetent. and they're highly leveraged. And 94% of the shares are available to the public. All right, PDLI. Highly leveraged. 91% of the stock is owned by the public. Lost money that last year, going to make money this year. And very incompetent. Well, the fact that they're making money this year versus losses last year means the stocks are going to go up. So if we buy them now, they're going to go up automatically. And then if we just turn around their management, they'll go up even further. Now, it's a little bit more long-term than the last couple of hit-and-run type investments we made. But there's really not a lot of options elsewhere. So I'm going to go ahead and get back into this game and into this industry, I mean, and buy these up and turn them around. So let's start with Immunex. I'm going to buy them. Start with the public, 94%. Okay, and next one is PDLI. Next one is Abgenix. And he's controlled by somebody. We're just going to buy that 75%. Last one was Millennium Pharmaceuticals. Okay. Millennium is the only one that we own outright. So we're going to make it the parent company and merge it with these other three. Before I merge it, I'm going to transfer cash to Millennium so that it can pay off the debts of the combined company. So I'm going to do a contribution. And I'm going to make it $7 billion. And if you notice, the stock price of Millennium has jumped to 229 based on that. So now I'm going to contribute the stock of these other companies to Millennium. Abgenix. PDLI and Immunex. So now this is Millennium. They have 588 in assets, and they have stock totaling 1504 and a bank loan of 565. Here's their stocks. These are the ones we just gave it. Okay, now what I'm going to do is I'm going to have Millennium merge with each one of these, and then we'll buy out all the minority stockholders. And we'll do that doing a Greenmail. So let's start with Immunex, and we will conduct a merger. Okay, Immunex is who we're going to merge with, and we have to offer all the shareholders of Immunex a premium. Basically, it's a incentive for them to agree to the merger, and since I own the majority of the shares, I already know you only need a 51% majority to approve the merger, and I already own that many, so the merger is guaranteed. So I'm going to keep this at the lowest rate so that all the minority shareholders don't get an extra bump. There's no reason to give them extra money. it's been approved. And now we will have the opportunity to liquidate Immunex. And I do want to do that. So I hit yes, and now that's done. So now we go to the next one, Abgenix. And it's the same process. And finally, PDLI. All right, so let's take a look at the combined company. $5.5 billion in assets, $4.7 billion in debt. Let's pay that off. Okay. So now we have a much healthier company financially, but we need to reform our management because they're still very incompetent. Now there's two ways to go about reforming your management. One is the slow and steady way, where you set your R&D for 10-15%, and over the course of a year or two, they get climb out of the basement. The other way is to set your R&D to 21% and above. And not only does that have a similar effect as just raising it to 16, in that the higher you make it, the more marketing you're doing, therefore your return should be better. But once it's above 21%, there is a random chance that your company could experience some kind of benefit, such as a major discovery, a excellent return on a marketing campaign, a major breakthrough in some research, a new discovery in medicine, whatever. There's all kinds of random events like that that can occur that will immediately take you out of the basement and put you into the very capable category. Now, because we're very incompetent, I'm seriously considering going the large route, especially since we have a surplus of cash. I don't typically like to have a surplus of cash because it makes you a target for embezzlement. But in this case, it'll help keep us alive until our management has been reformed. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to make our R&D 21%. I'm going to change our growth capacity to 1% and leave it there until I have a reason to change it. If the overexpansion continues, some of these more minor companies may dip down to the 100% range, and we may scoop them up with our extra cash as well. So let's go to management. Productivity spending 21%. Growth 1%. Okay, now let's look at the industry is still deteriorating, we knew that. And very incompetent, we're spending 21%. And we have a large tax carryover, so we shouldn't have to pay taxes for a while. Alright, so that's that. Now we still have $5.6 billion to spend. And the next thing that I want to do is I want to create a bank. And the reason why I want to do that is because I want to be prepared for when it's time to do interest rate swaps, which I hope to get to this episode. So the way you take over a bank is one of two ways. You can go to the banking industry and look for a bank that is ripe for takeover. Oops, no. Can't do projections. Summary. So this is a summary. So this bank is a good buy. What else? This bank is a good buy. This bank is a good buy. And that's about it. And something I think I failed to explain. These underscore C, that means it's open or owned by a corporate entity. H is the computer player, your competitor. And a P would be us. So let's look at how big Banco Santander is. And it's too big for us. So how about, what was the one up here? Was it this one? That's too expensive too. Let's see. Commonwealth Bank of Australia? Or is it Austria? We don't know. And that's too much money too. So it looks like our best bet is to just create our own. So to do that, you go to the financing menu and start up new corp. Okay? And the minimum for banks is $1,000 or, you know, $1 billion. So we hit yes and we pick banking and $1,000. Now our startup costs the first quarter are going to be huge, but we'll start earning money in the second quarter. I'm just going to leave the name the same for right now, and we'll leave it in the United States, that's fine. And I'm going to contribute an extra $1 billion. And that's so that we can, when we do interest rate swaps, the maximum amount that you can base the swap on is 60 times your net worth. But the maximum is 100,000 or 100 billion. Is that right? 100 billion. And I want to be able to do the maximum amount. So if our net worth is 2,000, multiplied times 60 is 120 billion. So we'll be able to do the full amount. So that's why I'm giving it an extra $1 billion. So here's the bank. It has 1670 in cash. It has business loans, consumer loans, and mortgages. Consumer loans is credit card debt. So if we want to look at the loans, oops, we go to the entity menu, and here's the list of the bank loans. So Centicor, Organogenesis, and then this is the credit card, prime mortgage and subprime mortgage, and the interest rate loan, interest rates on each of them. And we can freeze loans to any of these business entities, but we don't have any reason to do that right now. So what do we have left? We still have $3.6 billion. What we might do at this point is go ahead and make SunTrust Bank our bank. But we have too much cash. The regulators won't allow it. So we need to spend some of this before we can make SunTrust our bank. And I'm not really finding anything from this method to invest in. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to use the database and look for a stock that has, that's trading for less than 100%, that's in a industry that has good supply demand situation, that is not fully owned by another company, and that has earnings going up next quarter by at least 10%. And that gives us 25. And now we only have 3.6 billion to spend. So let's change this to 2 billion so that when we buy it, we can contribute our excess cash to it. All right, so let's display the results. And this is what we've got. Heavy machinery, office equipment, computer peripherals. Looks like there's two in the household and personal products. So let's take a look at that. Because usually when there's multiple ones, it means the industry is in a good situation for investing. So let's look. Yeah, see, a lot of them are growing at a negative rate, and the stock prices are in a good situation for us to buy. This is Shishido, and he's got a decent return. He's just got too much debt, and his dividend is too high for how much he's bringing in. So let's look at his financials. So we can buy him for $2 billion and then give him the extra $1.5 billion to pay down his debt. And let's see, he's scheduled to make money and he's reasonably competent. So let's buy him and see if we can't make a profit off of it. Bought him. Now let's contribute the 1300. Oops, wrong one. Capital contribution to Shishido. Cash 1300. Okay. And have him repay his loan. All right. Now let's see what we need to do management wise. Here's us. We need to eliminate our dividend, and growth rate we can set to 0, and then we're reasonably competent, so we can back this down to 6%. So dividend 0. R&D 6. And growth rate 1. Alright, now as we pay down our debt, we'll become more profitable. After that, we can worry about growing, provided that the situation, supply-demand situation, is still good. Alright, so we've been going for almost 25, 26 minutes, and we haven't even turned on the ticker yet. So let's turn on the ticker. The first thing that's going to come up is the bank earnings report for the new bank that we created. And let's clear this and reset it too. All right, so first one we want to put this in order of largest to smallest. So Millennium is our biggest, followed by Shishido, and then the bank. And then after that is the short sale of these. Okay, and just to show you what I was talking about with the tax basis info. So here's my report. I've made $1 billion here, $10 billion there, and $22 billion there. But when you look at it, it says that my total net worth is, you know, 10 whatever, and now over here it's 12 and change. So it's a little bit confusing because this is not a direct total it up, I guess. But anyway, let's turn on the ticker and get to the earnings report for the bank. So the bank lost $250 million, but we expected that with all the startup costs. But one thing I didn't do was adjust its R&D spending. And for a bank, it's marketing. See, it's projected to make money for the next quarter. But the management is reasonably competent, and we want to keep it there or increase it. So what we want to do, we're currently spending only 2% on advertising. So we want to change that to 6% until we reach very capable status, and then we'll lower it to 5%. If it were very incompetent, I would raise it up to 7 or 8. And usually 10 is the maximum that I go on banks. And the benefit that you get is that the cost, annual overhead and ad expenses, are currently 2% of deposits. That's right down the middle, but 1.5, 1.6 is where I would like it to be. We'll be more profitable if the expenses for those two things are low. All right, so the next report coming up is on January 10th for Millennium. It's either the 10th or the 11th, somewhere in there. And here it is, 57 cents. And still have plenty of cash on hand, so let's take a look at the management situation. It's dropped. That's not good. But we are projected to make a profit, and we lost last year, so that should help increase our stock price, which right now is $264, which is undervalued from our $292 net worth. So let's look at the industry again, just to make sure we don't need to adjust anything. All right. We are at a negative because of the amount that we're spending on R&D. But being that we're grossly incompetent, I'm not going to lower it. Okay, that's what the purpose of our cash reserve is to weather the storm until we reach a more profitable level. Now, I can change the management to try to turn this company around, and I'm going to go ahead and spend the $125 million to change managers. And furthermore, I'm going to elect myself as the CEO. For that, I will collect this salary. Okay, and between doing that and maintaining our R&D of 21%, hopefully the company will turn around. All right, so the next company that we expect a earnings report for is Shishido, and they're not due until the 19th of November. In case I haven't shown you this before, if you click on My Corporations, when you have more than one company, this gives you a nice little summary of what's going on with them. It shows you whether or not you own 100%, what their credit rating is, what their projected earnings for next quarter is, what their earnings for last quarter were, and what the year prior quarter earnings were. It's a good little tool for finding companies that you need to work on. So if the numbers are getting smaller left to right, then you need to make some kind of adjustment. If they're getting bigger left to right, you're doing just fine. So when you're going through to manage your companies, this is a good shortcut to use. All right, so we're going to fast forward now to November the 19th. Shishido made $1 a share, and it has $52 million in excess cash that we can pay towards our debt. But something happened while we were fast-forwarding that I want to point out. If you remember, we shorted Union Pacific at $10 a share, and now it's up to $40. And I think Norfolk, we shorted in the $15 range, and now it's at $40. I'm not really that concerned about it. There's no way that the industry could have turned around as bad as it was in this short a time. So I think they did a reverse split. So once we get done looking at Shishido, we need to go over and check those and see if it's time to cover our short sales. So we're going to go to Shishido and take a look at their cash situation, repay the loan. And now we'll look at the industry and see if we need to make any changes. It's growing now at 3%. Our return is good. So I don't see any need to make any change there. So let's go to Union Pacific. and look at the industry, and as you can see, they're all still negative. Of course, they're not as negative as they were, so we might want to cover our short sales. See, he's back up to 276%. Now, we still made a profit because, you know, he was 525 when we bought him, and his net worth has probably gone down, so even that 276 isn't the same as the 276 it was before. So he's only got $1 billion in equity. Right, so let's look at our tax basis info and see what we're going to get. So we could make $1.2 billion by covering it now. So this one we really haven't made any money on, but these two we've done okay. So let's see if he's still going down or not. And he is. He's not going down as much, but he's still going down. And he's actually in bankruptcy at this point. He's got a negative value. So all these calculations are NMF, meaning that it's no meaningful figure. If you have a division by zero or a division by a negative number, these will come up with that. I wonder if the others are the same way. Let's look at Norfolk. No, he's still got a positive value. But he's losing money. He's losing money even faster than he was before. So we can hold on to this one. We can hold on to Canadian. And I think maybe we're going to cover the UNP, because his losses have slowed down. That's ridiculous for his stock price to be that high when he's losing so much money. Now, we're going to hang on to all three of them. They're still losing enough money that we can make another, we can wait another quarter. I mean, the only downside is that we're going to have to pay the dividends on this one and this one. So we'll revisit that on January 10th, whenever Millennium's earnings report comes out. So we'll fast forward to January, and we'll be right back. Okay, so we made 90 cents a share, and our management is still reasonably competent, so we'll leave the advertising the way it is. Now, I don't really care if this bank makes money or not. You know, as long as it doesn't lose money, I'm happy. But the primary purpose for this bank is as a entity to engage in interest rate swaps when the time comes. But until then, I don't really care what happens to this one as long as it doesn't lose money. All right, Millennium's up next. And it lost a bunch of money. And it's because of what we're spending on R&D. But we still have plenty of cash reserves. So let's see what our management's doing now. Still grossly incompetent. Okay. Let's see what the rest of the industry is doing. See, they keep jumping. I mean, now they're even growing. They're growing even faster now. That's just ridiculous. And as a result, our percentage of earnings has gone down. You know, if we were very capable, this would be a positive number. But grossly incompetent, you know, it's just, We're just going to lose money for a little while until we can turn that around. I may even up the percentage a little bit more. Matter of fact, we're already losing money. We might as well jump it up and make it 25. That'll give us an even greater chance that we get lucky with a major discovery or breakthrough in the R&D department. Okay, let's look at Union Pacific real quick. Their earnings report comes out on the January, end of January, so before we have to pay dividends again, let's take a look. And they're still losing money hand over fist. So let's look at our tax basis report and see how much we can make now. So we've earned even more by hanging on to it here and here. This has been flat. And since we're not paying dividends on this one, we can hang on to it and just cover these two so that we don't have to pay dividends. So let's do that. Cover short position. And select this guy. Okay, and the one that we weren't going to cover is the one with no dividend, which is Canadian Railway. So we're going to cover Norfolk. Okay, we made a gain of 279. And so there we bought it back. And I want to see, I didn't catch what we had gained. I didn't catch the dollar amount, but it was should have been about $1.5 billion. All right, so we never did buy back that other 3%, did we? I forgot to do that. So here's the shareholders. I own 97%, SoftBank 1%, and Healthcare Equities Fund 2%. And while our stock is trading below the value, let's go ahead and buy it out so that we own 100%. We have the cash too. So the way that's done is you go to the buy-sell menu and you choose Greenmail. And you just pick the stockholder that you want to buy out and the percentage that you want to buy out. And this is just like buying out a shareholder when you're purchasing a company, except this time the company itself is buying back stock that's been issued. So we're going to offer 25%. They're considering it, and they've accepted. Okay, and we'll do the same thing for the other shareholder. 2%. We'll offer 25% premium, and they accept it. Okay, so, and that was 25% over the current stock price. So that further tightens up our shares. So like the total amount of shares outstanding now is only 29.11 million. So we basically canceled those shares by buying them back. Or the shares that those companies held. So now we own 100%. Okay, the other option was for me to spend my cash to buy them. But since this company has more cash than I do, I had the company just buy it back in a Greenmail. All right, so next one up is Shishido. And their next earnings are projected to be 207, which is good. We need some good news because Immunex is letting us down. All right, so February 18th, we'll fast forward to that. Shishido continues to run well, and it's got 300 million excess this time. So that'll put it, you know, a dent in this. It's over 10% of what we owe, so we're going to pay that down. And let's see what our earnings are supposed to be for next quarter. It's supposed to go up even further. So this is running well for us. I mean, these guys are expanding too much, but these guys are negative, and they offset that. So the situation is deteriorating, but it's not deteriorating that much. I mean, our income keeps going up. So there's no changes that need to be made there. We'll just continue to pay down our debt because growth is only going to dig into our profit margin. And we'll fast forward now to April 4th, when the bank issues its earnings report. Okay, I know I said I was going to let it run until April 4th, but we've got a situation coming up. Hopefully, we're going to get to do some interest rate swaps. Our prime rate has jumped. And if it gets to 12, we're going to start doing some swaps. So the interest rate has reached 11.5%, which is not ideal. I'd really like it to be 12% or higher to engage in interest rate swaps, but it's close enough. So before we get into actually doing the transactions, let me explain how they work. So in an interest rate swap, there's two different kinds. There's a long position and a short position. And in a long position, you receive a fixed rate. In a short position, you pay a fixed rate. So when the interest rate is high, we want to receive it, so we're going to be doing long position. And so what you do is when you enter into this transaction, basically what it is we're going to receive whatever percent we agree to based on the prime rate as it is today. And then we will pay whatever the interest rate is for the duration of the agreement. So if we're receiving 11% and the interest rate goes down to 8, then we'll receive 11, and it's based on $100 billion, then we'll receive $11 billion and we'll pay out $8 billion and we will collect the difference. So over time, and by the way, the maximum length of an agreement interest rate swap is 5 years. That's the maximum out you can make it. So over 5 years, so we've put $2 billion into our bank, and we're going to only have the bank engage in these swaps. So the maximum we're risking is $2 billion. If the interest rate goes up, then we'll go bankrupt, and we'll lose that $2 billion. But if the interest rate goes down, we'll make money. Based on this table, if the average rate over that 4.5 years, 5 years, is 10%, then we'll come out ahead to the tune of $3 trillion. If the average rate is 5%, then we'll make close to $19 trillion. If we get just the average of 8%, almost $9.5 trillion. So it's a huge upside with very little downside. Now, some people might say, well, aren't you kind of gaming the system here by agreeing to these swaps when you know you can't pay if the interest rate goes up? No. Because the companies that I'm entering into these agreements with may be in the same situation. Some of them are going to go bankrupt if the interest rate goes down to 5%. So in the real world, these swaps take place. It's known as derivatives trading. And it takes place on mortgages, straight up interest rates, you know, a number of different securities act as the basis for these types of agreements. And it's pure gambling. There's no question about it. It's pure gambling, but it's a good gamble. So we're going to take it. So it's April 4th, and here's the earnings report for SunTrust. We've made some money, and the interest rate is at 11.5%. We're not going to wait anymore. We're going to go ahead and do our interest rate swaps. It's not as high as we would like the interest rate to be, but it's close enough. So first thing we're going to do is we're going to set the ticker speed to zero or to one, and we're going to pause the ticker also. And now we're going to go to our interest rate swaps. Oh, we have the wrong entity. We need to select the bank. So the way it works is you go to the, like if I were to do an interest rate swap agreement, I'd go to other and then go to interest rate swaps. And now I put in my parameters. So I chose long position. I set the starting quarter to be 2 quarters away so that we have time for the interest rate to go down. And then the final quarter can be up to 5 years from this quarter, so third quarter of 2023. And when I make an offer, it'll randomly pick generally a bank, an insurance company, or a securities company. And you see here they're offering me a counter offer for 9.4%. Okay, but if I select the bank and I do the same thing, interest rate swaps, long position, first quarter of 2019 through the third quarter of 2023, and make an offer, the counter offer is a lot higher, 10.22%. Okay, so that's why you want a bank or an insurance company to do these. And already the interest rate, current interest rate, has dropped to 11.25%. But that's okay. We're going to go ahead and do as many of these as we can until the interest rate drops to where the counter offer is below 10% annually. So as long as the counter offer stays above 10%, we're going to enter into as many of these as it'll let us. So I'm going to fast forward and start entering into these agreements one after another. And when I come back, we'll put together an analysis of what we should look forward to. So the counter offers have started coming in at less than 10% per year, so we're going to take what we have and run with that and stop entering into any more agreements. And to view a list of your interest rate swap agreements, you go to interest rate swaps and then view a list of swap contracts. All right, so here they all are. First one was at 10.22%, and the interest rate fluctuated up and down as we went through. And so here's a list of all the agreements, okay? There's a total of 368 of them, and it took me roughly half an hour to put them in. Now, there's a cap that the system can hold, and that cap is 1,000. And I generally strive for 950 because that's usually, there's usually like anywhere from 25 to 50 interest rate swaps already going on that the system is tracking. So I try to make the maximum amount that I can. All right, so let's look at the spreadsheet then for what that means in terms of the 368 that we were able to enter. So here it is. So I've changed this number to 368. I've changed our average to 1022. And if we make the average interest rate back of 8%, then we'll be paid, $2.22 billion for each agreement every year on average. Okay. So if you take that $2.22 billion and multiply it times the 368, this is the number we get. After taxes, which is 26%, this is what our profit would be. And then over the course of the 4.5 years, this is what our total would be. So you can see by just a few clicks of the mouse, we've taken $2 billion and turned it into almost $3 trillion. Now, this is not guaranteed. This is based on the idea that the interest rate average will be 8%. Could be higher, could be lower. If it stays above 11% or even 10.22%, we're going to go bankrupt and we'll lose this $2 billion. Okay? But that's our maximum risk. That's the maximum amount we can lose by using the bank to do it. If we did this under our name, we would go bankrupt in this scenario and the game would be over. So that's why you want to use a bank to compartmentalize your risk. All right, so that's how they work. And we've been going for quite a while now, so we're going to end the episode here. But come back next time and see just how much of this profit we can realize. Until then, this is RakeM saying, have a good one.